guys about something. Hello, ballerina. So somebody else is going to join me on stage in a little bit. I'll introduce him as he comes along. But so we've been working on something for the last quite a while. And we want to talk to you a little bit about what it is and introduce you to this new thing we've been working on. So I have my projector here. All right. So let me motivate the problem and what we're trying to do and why we are doing it. So the world is changing. The world is changing in many ways, as usual, as always. But in the world of integration, one of the things that we talked about when I talked about in the morning about digital transformation and so on is that everything you do now involves using other people's stuff. That is, integration is no longer a niche. You depend on other people's stuff all the time. Network interactions are not some random thing. They are the replacement for the shared library. If you're old enough, you might remember .so files, you know, Java guys and so forth. Never heard of that stuff. But you know, that's how you shared code, right? There was a shared library. The shared library today is an API, is a network call to some system. Even databases, it's a network call. So the ability to write things that use things that are other people's stuff is absolutely critical. And that's fundamentally everywhere now. So everything we do, whether you write a new service, whether you write a new application, whether you write a new mobile app, it's all about using other people's stuff, right? So integration's everywhere. So that's the first point. Second one is this thing about configuration over code not workable at scale. Let me explain that. For a long time, we've had this mantra in software development and enterprise software and so forth called configuration over code. What does that mean? What that basically means is, generally, it was considered OK that when you buy a product, it's a sales line for the product to say, hey, you don't need to code anymore with this. You configure the product to do what it wants, right? Which is good, of course, right? Because the product does have a lot of stuff, and it meets many people's needs, so you need to configure it to do exactly what you want. But of course, the problem is, as time goes along, configurations have become extremely complicated. For example, we have some ESP, for example, has configuration over code. We have some customers that are running, you know, 10,000 line configurations. Okay, well, yes, that's still a configuration, but it's a complicated configuration. And configurations don't have the support of the full software development lifecycle toolset that we've gotten used to over the years. Right, so if you're looking at software development, there's a fantastic tool set in place now to write software, manage it, lifecycle manage it, continuous integration, continuous deployment, all of these things. There's a whole set of tools available for that. That's not there for configurations. We have one customer I met with last week. They have 30,000 engineers in the company. And they want to get to a point where every engineer should be able to write new services, new applications, new capabilities that touches other systems. And today's answer would be buy an ESP, WSO2 ESP, of course, put it together and write some configuration code. But the problem is, if you write 30,000 of them, and there's no, our wonderful ESP has no sharing architecture for code. There's no way to, like, I write something and I keep the capability, check it into a repository, build a dependency, let somebody else use it. That part is not there right now. So configuration over code, and that's not just us, every vendor in that space. And this particular customer is actually using one of our competitors' product. And there's issues with regards to expense, complexity, training, all this stuff, because it's a configuration over code thing. The third thing that's affecting the world today is everything is going small. Containers are everywhere now. Even we are running our integration cloud on containers. Containers are things that are meant to boot up and run extremely fast with very low memory footprint, because there's no full OS in there. A container can come up in a fraction of a second. So if the server that you're running in the container takes 30, 40, 50 seconds to boot up after that, that's kind of pointless, because the whole point of containers is to be able to do on-demand computing. Somebody's hitting the website, right then and there, you should be able to load a container up and deliver the request to that and execute it. That's how Gmail works, by the way. If you log into Gmail, when you log in, there's a container spawn up for you. And it lives around for you, and then it goes away. Right? So that kind of response is needed. Microservices are all about small things, micro integrations. Again, the ability to go small is very important. And this is really flying in the face of the way we've built server software for the last 20, 30 years. Because when you write a server software, the design point is the server boots up and keeps running for 6 months, 1 year, you never shut it off. I know we have many customers who run our software in production who basically never shut down the servers. Right? You don't reboot, you know, and we gone to great pains to make sure the software can run like that. Flatline memory, it doesn't leak memory, it collects after itself, it cleans up after itself, and so forth. So you can keep running it over and over again forever. But container architecture is completely different. You have a model of saying, hey, I got a request, let me boot it up, deal with the thing, or deal with a few requests, and get out of the way, and then let somebody else take over. So that also affects how you build the software, because it's no longer this model of saying, I'm going to put everything together into one server and manage it and so forth. One other aspect of this sort of isolation and small things that I want to bring up, again, something we learned from you guys, from several of our customers, we have many customers who are running hundreds of services and hundreds of integrations through the ESB, for example. And when you centralize a bunch of those into a single deployment, the problem is updates have to be synchronized, right? And that's really difficult because it's expensive and complicated, and you have to synchronize multiple teams, all of who have their own release cycles, and it becomes very difficult. So part of being able to run in small sizes is also being able to do that kind of incremental updates. So these are the motivations that asked us to think differently about how we do integration. There's a couple of other things, and then we were thinking about, okay, what's the right way to do it? So every ESB technology, whether you take WSO2 ESB or Mule or IBM or Oracle, or it doesn't matter, they all work on some kind of data flow architecture. You get a message coming in, and you flip around with it one way or the other, and eventually you send it out or send it back or whatever. Right? There's some kind of data flow model. You get a request, you represent somehow, you handle it, do transformations, call other things, integrate, et cetera, send it out. A data flow works. Of course it works. We have a product that does it really well. But it's not really scalable when you have multi-party people, multiple parties interacting and communicating and interacting in parallel, which is very, very common now. More and more integrations end up touching 5-10 other services in writing a new integration. Implementing that in a data flow language is possible, but it's ugly as hell. And when you come back and look at it later, it's very, very hard to understand exactly what's going on. What we have seen, so we've had, you know, sometimes we have into issues or we talk to customers about complex scenarios. Every single time we talk to a customer about a complex scenario, we draw a sequence diagram to explain the complex scenario. You always draw a sequence diagram and say, hey, this guy is doing this, this guy is doing this, this is where the coordination is, and then some other parallel activity happens and there's some coordination there, et cetera, et cetera. So sequence diagrams are the way in which you explain parallel coordinated activities. Okay? So, if sequence diagrams are a way to explain parallel coordinated activities, why are we stopping at just using them to explain things, to describe programs? So that's what we've been doing. So we've been working on something new. It's called Ballerina. That's why there were some ballerinas up here. It's a flexible, powerful, beautiful system. And what Ballerina is a programming language. It's a brand new programming language. It's a complete programming language that is designed that is a general purpose language. It's strongly typed, concurrent, you know, all the modern capabilities. But it's optimized for integration. That is, you can write a compiler with this thing. You can write, you know, Fibonacci sequence. You can write Bitcoin calculators, but it's not really meant for that. It's not the right language to use it. It's also extremely network aware. It's data aware. It's security aware. And it's not just a programming language. It's a whole programming system. And we've been inspired. We've learned a lot from Go and Java and Maven and all kinds of things. So the rest of this talk, and we're going to show you some code, show you some demos and so forth, is all about what this ballerina language is. So. Very high-level intro to start with. It's a language with an unusual behavior. Because we wanted sequence diagrams as a way to express complex stuff, we want to make sure there is 100% parity between the graphical representation, which is sequence diagrams, and a textual representation. And actually, we were inspired there quite a bit by, there's a website called websequencediagrams.com, which has a sort of a syntax for writing down sequence diagrams textually, and it'll immediately render it. This is way more powerful than that, but the idea there is we want to be able to say, this is the program that I've written, and it has a syntax that has a grammar, blah, blah, blah. It has a canonical graphical representation. So it's not that you're drawing pictures. There is a graphical editor you can use, but you're not drawing pictures. You're drawing the entities of the language, and when you draw the entities of the language, they lay out graphically. So there's, and they are 100% parity, and you can switch back and forth as a result of that. And of course, it knows about integration. That's the whole point, right? So it knows about HTTP, it knows about all kinds of APIs, it knows different kinds of data and so forth. And we'll get into that as we go along. Also, there is no magic. This is not a DSL. This is not a configuration language. This is a full programming language. It can do everything, basically. It's a full-scale programming language. And when you get into stuff, you'll see why we did it like that. And so there are no special syntax exceptions. Everything is derived from a few key constructs and built up into a proper system, right? And we've learned, again, from lots of other language systems and done it that way. The objective is to really significantly improve developer productivity and abstraction clarity. So the abstraction clarity is the big problem that you have in complex programs, complex interactions, integrations. And this thing really does a good job, we think, of solving that problem. At the same time, high performance is everything for us in this in the use cases that we are going to be using this for. So it's designed for very, very low latency, low memory footprint execution. It boots up in a fraction of a second and runs, you know, with very little memory footprint and so forth. So here's a very, you know, the usual program you have to see, hello world in Ballerina. It just says a function, main, you know, string array args, and system colon print line, hello world. That's it. So now we've seen some code, we'll get into more. But before we go further, let me introduce Samira here, and we're going to launch Ballerina to the world. What we're going to do is, so Samira, come on up. I'll introduce Samira first. So this is Samira Jayasoma. He's one of our... He's an architect in WSO2, and he's been the lead ballerina working on this product. So we're going to launch this to the world. The way we're going to do it is we're going to run a ballerina program that'll blast out a bunch of tweets and Facebook posts and a bunch of other things from ballerina itself, and then we'll come back and look at the code.
I'm going to run one of the most important scripts. So let me announce Ballerina into the world. All right. All right.
We're done. All right. So thank you. Don't worry. We're going to look at the code in a little bit. We're going to come back and look at the code. Let me explain some concepts so you understand the code when we look at the code, right? And now it's sending out a bunch of stuff in parallel. So we'll see. Okay. So switch back to my screen. By the way, this is still a technology preview, so I had to re-emphasize that. There are many things that are not done yet. There's a bunch of things that we are still working on. There's a bunch of things we want to get your input. That's why we are putting it out as an early stage technology preview. The official version number is 0.8, but there are many, many things that we know that can be improved, should be improved, and I'm sure there are other things that we haven't thought about that you guys can tell us. So please participate, and we'll give lots of pointers in it as we go along. Okay. Let me talk about the concepts of Ballerina. So there are six key concepts I'm going to talk through, and then we'll look at more detailed things. So services, resources, connectors, actors, and functions and workers. I'm going to start in slightly different order, talk about a function. Well, a function is just a function. You just saw main. Main is a function. Main is, of course, a special function, because if we call it main and its signature is it takes an array of string, it's meant to be called from the shell, like what he just ran. And a function has a worker. A worker is a parallel thread of execution. So you can have any number of threads of execution. So sequence diagram thing, right? So you have lines of execution. These are the actors. And they are threads of execution. And you program them by putting code into that. So there's a graphical editor, of course. That's a composer that we'll show you, that you can drag and drop stuff. And of course, there's syntax. And we're going to go through the code in multiple forms as we go along. And each statement just runs sequentially. This is a normal imperative program. Nothing funky, nothing special there. And of course, you package it up, and you can call it. I'll get into connectors and actors in a second. Resource is a packaging of a function which is meant to be a network-accessible endpoint. So Ballerina is kind of unusual in that Ballerina, as a language, knows about the concept of services and resources. Right? It is not an add-on layer. So when you look at Java or Go or any of these languages, Java doesn't know the concept of a service. Right? Java, in the case of Java, you write a Java class. And then you annotate it in some form, and some runtime environment prepares an appropriate environment and hands the request over to it. Here, the runtime environment itself knows the concept of a service. Right? So resource and service. So resource is a single entry point. And in a sequence diagram speak, the only difference between a function and a resource is kind of that you also represent the caller who is making the network call as an actor. And you say at some point, a message comes in, and then you do your stuff. Right? And service is a collection of these things. And of course, you can have, and the server itself knows that it is attached to a ballerina program has to interact with outside people. So that has this concept called connectors. So there are two kinds of connectors. The ballerina program can be invoked from outside. Right? Those are called server connectors. And we have server connectors for HTTP, for JMS, for WebSockets, whatever. You can keep writing any number of things you want as long as there are network protocols. We can keep adding those. Client connectors are things that the ballerina program is calling out to, interacting with as a client. And even at that level, there's network protocols like HTTP, FTP, JMS, etc. Plus, there are on top of that, you have APIs and so on, right? So you have an HTTP connection, you wrap it up into an OAuth connection, and then you wrap it up into an API, etc. So those are what the endpoints are. Sorry, I forgot to mention one thing in my picture. Let me go back for a second. So what you see on the right, the connector, that's the representation of a remote endpoint. So that's so every ballerina program might be interacting with people outside. When the people interact with people outside, we represent that person outside, that entity network endpoint, as a vertical line, as a connector. Right? And then an action is something that interacts with that. So actions are the ones that actually end up sending a message or sending some messages or whatever and getting some response back or responses back. And there's more powerful stuff we'll get into. Okay? Sorry about that. I forgot to mention that. So the interesting aspects of Ballerina, first thing is it knows services. And of course, main, right? So every programming language knows how to be a main. You know, you run main and it runs somehow. And there's varying forms of what main means. In the case of Ballerina, it knows two kinds of execution by birth. It knows that I have to run as a network service, which means I have a collection of entry points, and you bind the collection of entry points to the program, and you have a normal regular main. It knows data. So XML, JSON, and data tables are built-in data types. So this is a little bit like, there was a language called Link, which added XML to C#, E4X added XML to C#, to JavaScript. So it's a little bit like that. It has inherent knowledge of XML as a data type and JSON as a data type, and also data table. Data table is basically a representation of a tabular data set. And it can be representing a result from a database query, for example. And so there's data integration is part of the language. We'll get into that later on when we talk about some of the use cases and also some samples. And everything designed to be streamed and high performant. That is, whether it's XML or JSON or a data table, we don't suck it into memory, of course. Can't do that for anything meaningful. So it's designed to work in a model where it only brings in whatever it needs to bring in, and then it keeps executing on top of that. It also understands that this data often needs to be messed around with. So the type system understands that you need to map data from XML and JSON and data tables into the language itself. Right? It knows network APIs. It's born with the knowledge of a bunch of things, and it's got a whole bunch of network APIs. So you can plug in whatever network API you want. So we've already written connectors for HTTP 1, HTTP 1.1, HTTP 2, WebSocket, JMS, SFTP, etc., and more, and so forth. Sorry, I should mention the ones at the bottom. So once you've got the basic HTTP connector, you can write an OAuth connector. An OAuth connector is something that knows how to maintain an OAuth protocol handshake on top of an HTTP connection. Once you have an OAuth connection, you can use that to talk to any OAuth protected API. So that's what we've done. So we have HTTP connector is the lowest level connector. We write an OAuth connector on top of that. Then use that to write connectors for Twitter, Gmail, LinkedIn, etc., which are all protected using OAuth. That's OAuth 2 stuff. Ballerina also knows Swagger. Actually, it's not just no Swagger, it is Swagger. Let me explain that. So in the case of HTTP, when you write a Ballerina service, you bind the Ballerina service to HTTP. When you bind the Ballerina service to HTTP, the interface of the service that you wrote has a representation which is in Swagger. Okay, so it is not that you take this Ballerina service and you say, generate me a Swagger. You take the Ballerina service and say, let me look at you as Swagger. And then the implementation details are no longer visible because it's only the interface, because that's all Swagger can handle, and it shows the interface. So if you edit the interface in Swagger and you switch back to the view of Ballerina source code, now there may be another resource or some resource may be gone and so forth. So it's a model where it deeply understands Swagger as a way of representing HTTP endpoints. And so you can edit it anyway. So what this does is, one of the main limitations of contract-first design is you start with a contract. Contract-first design is generally a good thing. Everybody preaches that. So we just sit down and design the interface, then write the code. So design the interface, write the code. It has the problem that if you don't get the interface exactly right, if you take the interface, you generate a skeleton, start writing code, and you then realize, oh, crap, I forgot something. I need something else. You can't really go back and add another one, right? Because there's no way to do that. This addresses that to a significant extent. There are still issues. For example, if you added a resource and then you go to the interface and remove the resource, then the implementation's gone too, right? So there's some undo stuff, for example. But it reduces a huge amount of limitations of standard interface first design approach. Ballerina also knows Docker. So that is, Ballerina command has a way to say, please package this up as a Docker image, and then run it on some container environment. So we've kind of taken into account all the usual environment that we live in today and made it all part of it. It is highly extensible. It has a package model. And code is organized into packages like Go, and similar to Java, but more like Go than Java. It also has a repository model. So it understands that in today's development world, we share code all the time. People write code, push it out, publish it into a repository, people suck it in, use it, and keep going and so forth. Right? That's the way people write code today. Every new programming system, if you look at Node, for example, all of them have it. In the world of Java, Maven, et cetera, is not part of Java, but really you can't do Java development without Maven. So it is really part of Java, et cetera. So this thing has a similar model. There's a network, there's a repository architecture, so you can build an ecosystem of contributions, whatever kind of contribution. It can be functions or any library, basically. The network connectors that I mentioned, I briefly mentioned this. The connectors are recomposable. That is, if I've written a connector that speaks a particular network protocol and does something, I can write another connector that uses this connector now. Because from a sequence diagram speak, it's basically saying a connector just becomes a vertical line and has some actions. And then if I use that one and build another connector, that's just a new vertical line for somebody else, right? With a different set of actions. Again, we have code that will show you all this stuff for real. It's completely open source. There is a patent we filed because it turns out nobody's actually written a way to take a sequence diagram and make it into a service and so forth. So we have filed a patent for it, the code is 100% open source. It's under Apache license. It's available right now. The repo is public now. And there's a bunch of channels to engage. The language spec is also there. It's still, again, work in progress. So our objective is to really open this out and try to make this into a open language that many people can fiddle around with and play with and do whatever they want with it. OK, that's enough of talking about random stuff. So let's quickly go through the launch program code. So I'm going to ask Samir to come back up, and we'll walk you through the launch program code so you see what it did. And hopefully it actually worked.
OK, so this is the command we ran earlier. So the command is ballerina run main and a ballerina source file. So here, we basically executed the main function. So I'll just open up the main function. All right. Can everyone see? It's big enough. Yes. So I think Sanjiv explained the concept of connectors, the main functions, and the service capability in Ballerina. So here, what we have done is we have created a launch service connector, which means we have some service running somewhere, which basically accepts request, and we just did a post message with this string message, right? So, and then it basically post, get the response, and basically print the response into the system out, right? So if I open up the service, I will just reduce the font size. Yes. So what we have done in this program is we, in Ballerina, there's a concept called fork join, where you get a message, and you can basically parallelly execute a bunch of tasks using the concept called worker. So here you can see we have the fork join. Underneath we have workers. Like if you think about this in Java, this is like a thread of execution. So each thread of execution has its own tasks, right? So I'll just go through the workers. There are six different workers here. If I explain the first one, this one basically tweets the message that came from the request to the WSO2 Twitter account. So we get all the credentials via environment variables. And then second one basically publish the same message into the WSO2 Facebook. Third one publish the same message to the WSO2 conference Twitter account. Fourth one, WSO2 conference Facebook page. Fifth one, it publishes the same tweet to the ballerina-lang Twitter account, and then the last one to the ballerina-lang Facebook page. So it has executed six different tasks parallelly, and if I go to these pages, refresh, yeah, you can see this message. So this is the message that we basically posted to all the six different channels. And this is a WSO2 Twitter. OK. And then, yes, WSO2 conference. Thank you.
So it worked. That's good.
This is WSO2 conference page, WSO2 conference Twitter page. It's all in there. And our new ballerina-lang Facebook page. You can see the post as well as to the ballerina-lang Twitter. All right. So that is what the script did actually. It basically parallelly executed six different tasks. And at the end, we basically have a join condition. Here, the join condition is we have six different workers, and we're going to wait until all six arrives. There are like different join conditions. You can wait until any of your workers finish jobs. Like we have some syntax. We can go through that later. In case if there are timeouts, you can handle that as well. So that is basically the code we executed.
Thank you. Thanks. And also, by the way, this particular code was shown using Atom, and this is using the Atom plugin that we've written for Ballerina. That's the one that's doing the syntax highlighting and so forth for Atom. All right, thank you, Samir. Okay, let me kind of walk you through the language to give you a sense of the language. I'm not going to go through every little bit detail of it, but enough to give you a fairly good understanding. And again, the GitHub repo is up. You can access it right now, and the spec is there as well. Okay, so let me start with modularity. So one of the things we wanted to address very carefully in Ballerina that we don't see any other integration like language addressing is the idea that code has to be manageable. This programming language code, if you write any kind of language today, you have to think about other people using code, sharing it, and publishing it, and managing namespaces, and so forth. That's what the modularity architecture is. This particular aspect of Ballerina comes primarily from Go. So Go has a packaging model where it uses a directory for packages instead of the Java packaging model, and that's the same model we use. So file names don't matter in Ballerina, basically. What matters is the name of the package, which is a directory hierarchy, and the name of the thing that you put inside the file. So if you create a service called foo, then the foo matters, but the fact that service foo lives in x.bel or y.bel makes no difference. Once it discovers everything, it builds a symbol table, and that's it. It doesn't care after that. So you have a package is defined by the set of all files in directory, which export a set of symbols, basically. right? And you have a way of accessing them, there's a way of importing them, and of course we have some reserved packages that give the system functionality. So every bit of functionality in Ballerina that the system gives to developers to build on is in a ballerina.something package, right? Everything else is just a little bit of syntax. After that, all the functionality is in ballerina.lang, ballerina.star packages. That's, again, similar to the way Java works, and Go, and a bunch of languages now do it like that. System libraries are just another kind of package, basically. There's a versioning architecture we've designed. It's not fully done yet. One of the problems, again, this is a very common problem. Versioning is critical if you're going to build a large-scale system where you have different people writing code and depending on each other. Without versioning, it simply doesn't work, basically. And every language typically punts on this and says somebody else deals with it. Even Java doesn't solve it. Maven has a solution for it. OSGI has a solution for it. But Java doesn't know about it. So at runtime, you can get class cast exceptions because of that. Here, we are trying to address that. We have an architecture. There's a bit of it in the spec, but there's more work. We are not done yet. The type system of Ballerina is a standard kind of type system. There's value types, reference types, and this thing called iterators we're still finalizing. Let me just focus on the first two things. Value types are value types. They have int, float, string, and boolean. Int and float, we are just adopting 64-bit numbers and saying you don't really need to have long and double and blah, blah. So it's really long and double if you're a Java programmer. It's not int and float. String is considered a value type. So obviously, strings are not values in the same style. But we made them value type because they're so commonly used in these kind of scenarios. Making it more complicated is not easy to use. Then reference types, there are two type constructors, struct and array, as well, which you can use to create any kind of reference type that you want, plus a bunch of built-in reference types. Right? Those are the ones that sort of bootstrap the system. So for example, there's message, map, exception, XML, XML document, JSON, data table. So XML, XML document, JSON, data table are the related to XML, JSON, and data stuff. Exception is a, sorry, XML, those four. Exception is the type that we use to represent an exception. So there's an exception handling architecture in the language. Map is a map. Message is the one kind of opaque representation we have. That is how when a request comes in over the network, we have to deliver it in an abstract form to the handler for that without binding it to a particular network protocol. So that's what this message thing is. And then protocol-specific functions can be used to extract stuff out of the message. Right? So this is a little bit ugly, but there's no way to do it without it. An iterator is a way of creating an iterator from a collection, and there's some stuff there, but it's not done yet. And if you're interested, look at the doc. There's a bunch, some comments there. We talk a little bit more about JSON, XML, and so forth. So there's a data type called JSON, basically. You declare a variable saying JSON X. Now X is a variable of type JSON. It's a little bit more advanced than that. You can also optionally give a JSON schema name. If you give a JSON schema name, it says the value of this variable will be conformant to that schema. Now, we don't always enforce that. Actually, this part is not implemented yet. But we are not planning to enforce that every time you assign a value because that will become non-performant, but then have a library function that lets you validate that, basically. Right? So you can associate a schema and say, that's the type I want. If not, it's just a JSON thing. And there's also JSON literals. So you can assign a JSON value to a variable by simply putting a literal JSON in there. And in the JSON, you can refer to variables that are defined, that are in scope using a particular syntax, a dollar curly brace syntax. XML is very similar. There's a type called XML. And there's also a type called XML document because XML and XML document are different. XML refers to XML element. XML document refers to a complete XML document. And then you need a bit more stuff there. Same model. You can associate an XML schema and say, I want it to constrain to that thing. Right? And again, XML literals in a similar way. Tabular data support. So we have a variable data type called data table. So you say data table X, and you use a connector that knows how to speak to a database and do a query. And once you do the query, and we'll show some samples of this, when you do the query, what you get back is a data table. And then you have a cursor-based API for pulling data out of that. Right? So it's a little bit like, if you're familiar with Java, it's like a result set, basically. Right? So result set wrapped into a native type in Ballerina is kind of how it works already. And there's a bunch of connectors. So right now, we have implemented a SQL connector and also, I think, a couple of NoSQL connectors. But we have a product called data services. So this is really the functionality of the data services product. right? So we are also working on adding transactions to this, so you'll be able to do a database query from one and to another database and do that in a transactional way, or bring a JMS connection to the same transaction and so forth. So transaction stuff will be built into the language. So we're working on that right now. Typing, so when you have data types, you have to deal with type coercion, type conversion. So there's a bunch of standard coercions defined, the lossless conversion. So if you have gone from int to float, you don't need to ask, we can do it. There are also others that you can convert by invoking casting, sort of normal programming language stuff, right? You say cast, and you put the type name that you want to go to, and it'll cast to that. But it's a bit wacky in this language. We actually allow you to extend the castable typeset by writing a type mapper and registering it into the language. I'll explain that in a second. So there's a syntax, actually, for saying, I want to write a type mapper, and this type mapper goes from this type to that type. And here's the logic for doing that conversion. The reason we need this is in many integration scenarios, when you are doing XML types or JSON types or ballerina types, you often have to take the data from here, and it's in this kind, and do a projection, do a combination, do all kinds of data mapping kind of stuff. So this brings the concept into the language. And there is syntax for defining it. There's more constraints coming. It's not going to be any statement you can put in there. We have a graphical editor for this we have worked on as well. So you can, like normal data mapping stuff, bring the schema of this side, schema of that side, draw lines and apply functions in the middle and so forth. So this is like a serialization of that. Right? So this gives me a chance to kind of explain a syntactic design point we have taken into account in the entire language, which is, we're very keen to maintain the visual, the graphical representation capacity. So there are some things we've done to the syntax which might look a little bit wacky, or some constraints we've introduced to the syntax which might seem a little bit unusual. And that's there primarily to make it possible to have a clean visual representation. Because sometimes if you allow totally arbitrary stuff, we can't back out. We can't come back into the graphical representation. So we don't do that as a result. OK, let me walk through a couple of the language statements. Usual stuff, assignment statements, if, while, break, try, catch, throw, return, action invocation, which is like the stuff I told about earlier, fork, join, etc. I'm not going to go through all of them. There are samples. There's all kinds of code. I'll just go through fork, join, and the last one, just because they're kind of different and interesting. Samira just showed an example of using fork, join. So fork, join is if you think graphically, fork, join basically says, I'm working on this work a thread. I want to take this work item, this data, and give it to five people and let them run things in parallel. And I'm going to draw five lines now below me and write my code in each of the five lines. This guy's going to do this, going to do this, going to do that. And then at the end, I'm going to rejoin it back. And there are different join conditions. So Samira mentioned this already. The example we use uses a join condition of all, which means wait for everybody to do their job and then come back. You can say join condition of any, which means any one, or you can say any k, all k of the following k, etc. There's a bunch of options. Right? Again, the spec has a bunch of things. So this is a way of taking a sequential execution and parallelizing and then bring it back. This is not a novel concept. There are lots of programming languages that have fork join kind of things. So this is a fairly common thing we've adopted. But it fits beautifully to graphical syntax. Unfortunately, our graphical editor is still currently not having this feature. It will have it very soon. But the current version of the composer you can download today doesn't have the graphical representation of fork join yet, but it will have it soon. So this is roughly what it looks like pictorially. This is the design, one of the design docs that we had. So you have one thread, and inside that thread, suddenly you get like multiple threads temporarily. And they do their thing. When they finish, you merge. So the worker is the concept we use to represent a parallel line of execution. And once you can spin up a worker in certain places, not everywhere. And once you spin up a worker, you can interact with it. So the way you interact with it by sending it a message, right? So because it's a separate thread of execution, there's no shared memory architecture. So we don't allow one worker to go and pull off variables from the other worker, right? So there's an explicit message delivery involved to trigger that off. And once you trigger it off, you can get a message back from it to provide the synchronization across workers. Right? And on the other side, there's a reply construct. So the reply construct is the one that triggers the worker to send the response, which will unblock message left arrow worker name. OK, so ballerina is not just a programming language. There's a bunch of supporting stuff you need if you're going to create a programming language these days. It's not, you don't just write a language interpreter or a compiler and say, OK, I'm done. because that's not the way programming works anymore. So we built most of that stuff, and there's more work to be done, but we built a bunch of pieces. Let me walk you through a couple of those very briefly, just to give you a flavor of the stuff that we've done. And all of these are available for download. So first one is a Composer is a editor that we've written. It runs in the browser. I think I have a slide on that. And lets you do a bunch of stuff. And then also IDE plugins. You know, most of us are like religious people when it comes to IDEs, right? You know, you don't convert religions that easily. You don't convert IDEs that easily. So we're not trying to move a IDEA user into the ballerina editor. We're not trying to move a VS Code editor into this. So our intent is to write IDE plugins for basically all the IDEs that are there, all the popular IDEs. So we have written 5 of those. Those are going to be available. You can download them right now. And there's something called Dockerina. It's not Dossarina, it's Dockerina. I know Dockerina has a problem because it sounds like Docker, but it's not Docker. Dossarina is a Dockerina, sorry. Is it a create documentation? Let me talk about that. Actually, I have slides on this. So Composer is a graphical editor that runs in the browser. So the way it works right now is you run the Composer program. When you run the Composer program, it runs a server, and you just point your browser to it. And it lets you edit ballerina programs using an IDE-like experience, an editor-like editor experience similar to Atom. It uses something called ACE, which is another JavaScript editing framework that we're using. We don't currently package it as a downloadable thing, but we probably will do that at some point using Chromium. There's tools that package it up and put it out and make it available so you can just run it and it comes with embedded coding Chromium. It'll also be hosted in the cloud. Once we get this fully into the cloud, you'll be able to edit this stuff directly in the browser in the cloud. You don't have to go open something else. And this thing actually is kind of cool. You'll see a little bit of it when we get there. It does all 3 representations of a ballerina program. So there's a graphical representation, there's a textual representation, and the swagger representation. And you can switch back and forth and edit any of them. Right? Again, 0.8, so there are some glitches, so be patient. IDE plugins, we've just released 5 IDE plugins, Atom, Vim, IDEA, Sublime Text, and VS Code. And more have to be done, and there's more that have to be done for these as well. There's also an interesting project called langserver.org that we are looking at, which lets you write a plugin for LangServer using the LangServer APIs, and there's plugins for lots of IDEs for that thing. Once you do that, that gets syntax highlighting, debugging, all that kind of stuff. So the Composer has debugging as well. Obviously, we haven't done debugging in these yet. But at some point, to be complete, you need to have that. So Dockerina is a tool to generate API docs. So if you write a program, you have to be able to document it. And the way we do documentation, when you see the language spec, you'll see we've taken a very opinionated view about documentation. Actually, Ballerina has lots of opinionated views about things. So the documentation part is kind of strongly opinionated, which is the following. So in most programming languages, documentation is an afterthought. Every programming language has a commenting architecture. You look at C, going all the way back to C, C++, Java, C#, everything has a commenting architecture. Then later people say, well, okay, actually we need to be able to document this damn thing. Just comments isn't enough. Let's put some structure into the comments. That's how JavaDoc was born, right? From the xdoclet heritage. And that's kind of the pattern that everybody follows. So we haven't done that here. We've decided that documentation is first class. If you're going to write stuff, you've got to document the damn thing. So to make it first class, we have a set of annotations that you must use to document it. You cannot put a comment to document stuff. Comments are just allowed within the code for you to comment the code. That's it. Right? You can't use comments to document. You want to document? Document. That's it. Right? And then Dockerina will go and pull them out and generate a nicely formatted HTML API doc representation. Right, so you can browse through that and so forth. All the ballerina stuff we've done is documented like that. So there's an API doc link on the website that shows you all the API docs. That's done using this thing. Testarena. We're running out of interesting names. So this is a unit test and mocking framework. Again, if you're going to write programs and you're going to write lots of programs and you want continuous integration, continuous delivery, and so forth, unit testing. Right? You can't say, I wrote code. It just runs. I need to have a testing mechanism. So this has a way to test any ballerina piece of code, as well as mock it. That is, if you have a code that calls a service, it has a mocking framework. So you can write another service in the test itself and sort of reflectively edit the thing that you're testing to change the endpoint is going to the mock, right? So, and then run the test. So that allows you to create unit tests that actually can test network applications as well. Packerina is still coming, but there's bits of this is already shipping. So part of the package aspects of it, so to manage a repository, to discover stuff, to build programs and so forth, that's what this tool is. Part of it is already shipping, but the whole thing is not there yet. OK, that's enough. Let's switch to code again. We'll go through a bunch of samples. We'll do a bit of a joint act on walking you through a bunch of demos so you kind of see the code a little bit more. Switch the screen, guys. OK.
Yes. So first of all, I will just close the server service that was basically doing the fork join and publishing so that we don't have any port conflicts. All right. So the first sample, we will write a very simple ballerina service, which basically a hello world ballerina service, right? Which, so you pass your name as a get query parameter, the service will return hello world your name. That's a very simple service that you can think of. So in ballerina, as Sanjiv explained, we have the concept of a service. So this is, I'm using the Atom plugin. So you give a name, hello service. And so this, I'll just quickly implement the structure, the skeleton. So let's do a simple resource. Let's say hello. So this is your input, the request message to your resource. Someone else is invoking, and you get a message. As Sanjiv explained, it is, this message contained all the data that comes with the GET request. All right, so now the service needs a base path or a context. If you're familiar with Java, you have servlets, you have a context. So in ballerina, you can give a context via the base path.
So that's an example of using annotations to bind the service to a particular protocol.
Yep. And then we need to basically annotate this resource. We need to specify whether this is a post, get, like the HTTP method. So I will use HTTP, get, and then the path. So I will put path slash hello. So you would be invoking the service, hello service slash hello. And then if I want to accept any query parameter, I would do something like this, name, URL templates. And then you can basically get the name. So this is a string, name. And I can specify that as a query param. And the query param is mapped to name. So this is a contract. And then we will implement the body of the resource. So let's design our response message as a string. It could be message hello world, your name, maybe, and the new line. Right, so this is your, and let's define your response message. So this is the request message, which we are going to actually, in this case, it's a get, so we're going to ignore the get request. So we're going to define response message. And so this is how you assign, initialize the reference type in ballerina. So message, XML, JSON, Sanjiv explained this, are all reference types. So this is how you can initialize a reference value. So this is an empty message. So I'm going to set, I will explain what this. There's a method called set string payload. And you need to specify the message. That is my response message. And the string. So this method will basically add the string payload into your response message. And it will automatically set the content type to text, the text type. And then, since this is a resource, what you do is you reply with the response. And so this message and messages, here the message is the type. Messages is a package which contain utility methods. You can to manipulate the message. So here we use messages, set string payload, and you pass the message. And since this is a package, you need to import this. Ballerina, lang, message. So this is our Atom plugin. So let me double check the syntax.
So query param attribute supposed to be HTTP colon or?
Not at the moment, I think. Okay. So we should change that. I think it looks good. Let me save it. And so this is under this, yes. I'll go back to my console. I will open the first sample. Okay. I'll open using Vim. We have a Vim plugin as well. So we have developed a Vim plugin. So if you are a Vim user, you can download and install this Vim plugin as well. Let me quickly run this. So how you start a service in Ballerina? We have a Ballerina command. If you just type it, it will show the available commands. I think Sanjiva explained the doc, swagger, the test arena, the build command. This is part of the pack arena. And so there are various things available in Ballerina. So you run a service, run service, and the file. Let's see. Yeah, it runs. And it is available on this interface. So I'm going to go to the browser and do a simple get. Port 9090. Hello service. Yeah, so you get the response. So it's the simplest service that you can write in Ballerina. So that gives you an initial idea of the syntax and the capability. So let's move on to a more complex sample. I will open that sample in our IDEA plugin. Yep. So this is actually a data service which demonstrates the data integration capability in Ballerina. So if I go through this service briefly, so you can see we have basically declared an SQL connector. And we have passed a bunch of properties. That properties contains the database URL, username, password, and all that. So we get them from environment variables. It's not a good practice to hard code. And then we have designed this API as a like CRUD operations. You have get all employees. This is basically an employee database. You have get employee, you can pass the ID and get the employee. Insert employee, update employee, and delete. So here, if you quickly look at the get employee method, we have already defined the database connector, SQL connector, and we simply execute the select query. And you give the select all employees, and you limit the number of rows. So suddenly you get the data table. I think Sanjiv explained the concept of the data table. Now here you can convert this data table object into a JSON payload. Right? As soon as you do this, we don't convert that into JSON. But as soon as you reply, basically at that JSON payload, and you invoke messages, call and set JSON payload, and you reply, then only we start serializing the data. We don't load all the data into the memory. It supports a streaming, right? Yeah, so maybe we can start this and run a simple query. I'll stop the previous service. This is sample number two. Ballerina. Yeah, so in order to this to work, I need to basically set some environment variables. So environment variables is obviously not set. Let me get those from here. And then run the service. It started. So according to the, I can do employees slash get request. It should send me all the JSON messages. I'll quickly open advanced REST client. Yeah, if I do employees, it should give me the complete data set. Sorry. It always get that. I'll show that using.
Just use the browser.
Just use the browser. All right. Yeah. Then it, you get your 100 requests. Thank you. Yes. So that this is like so earlier in if you're using WSO2 products, you can do the same thing in our data services product. But this is like another way of doing that. Maybe a much simpler way of doing the same thing. Using a proper programming language. And then if you want to filter out, let's say you have the ID.
By the way, this is the sample database from MySQL that we're using. So.
Yeah, we're using the sample database. So I'm going to filter employee using ID. I should get that. Right? That's simple stuff. All right, so let me quickly open this service using our Composer. Composer is our graphical editor. First of all, I will start the Composer. So it's a browser-based editor. So I'll open it here. Yeah. So this is our Composer. And I have added my project folder. You can basically, you can go to this view and you can add your project folder. Just quickly open this. Yeah. So I think Sanjiv explained, like, if I collapse this, collapse all that so that I can explain. Yeah. So this is like overview of the employee data integration service. As you can see, this is my service. And you can see all the annotations. That's base path annotation. This is where you define annotations. And in the service, you have like five different resources. So this is the get all employees service that we, resource that we just invoked. And if you look at the content, it has the resource worker, client representation, and it has a bunch of statements. So these are statements. Here we initialize the SQL parameters, and here we basically do an action. Basically perform the select query. So you can write all that here. And then we basically map the JSON, basically map the data table into the JSON, and all that. So this is one view of, and if I open the insert employee, it performs a bunch of stuff. So this sample is a bit boring because it has only one connector. So if there are multiple connectors, you would see there are connectors line up here. And the other thing is about the sample is this connector is shared with all the resources, right? In Ballerina, you can define a connector inside the resource. It's like I can, but before doing that, I will just go through the tool palette. I'll quickly show some, yeah. So all the language constructs, you can drag and drop to this view. So let's say I'm going to drag and drop a function. So you function, and then if I want to invoke an HTTP URL, I would get import ballerina-net HTTP client connector and drag and drop. So I'll let me name this HTTP endpoint, right? And then I would do a GET request from my function. So it represents the actions. So this is the GET action. So I can, and then the next would be, for example, let's say I want to do SQL connection from the same function, and I would do a SELECT query. It will automatically connect to the SQL endpoint. Yeah. Right. So likewise, you can basically design your integration using sequence diagrams. You can model your design using sequence diagrams. Now, what Sanjiv explains about the design view, source view, and swagger, so let's go through. So this is a function. Let's go through the source view. And you can see generated source. And the new function is available somewhere here. And if I start editing here, let's say I'm going to define a variable. This is a very sample. I do a if condition. A equals, let's say, 5, A greater than 5. I do something, let's say, A equals 10. And then in the else condition, I do A equals 1. It's just a dummy sample. And if I go back to the editor, you would see that here. It is reflected automatically, right? So you have your if condition here, right? Thank you. And the if condition, you can also add the else if. Like, this is like very brief overview of brief demonstration of the editor capabilities. And another factor is, let me quickly delete this. So this is a service. So Sanjiv explained about the swagger view. So I can go to the swagger view, which is somewhere here. If I go there, yeah. So from here, go to the back, come back. Yeah, there are some minor glitches. Anyway, you can see the generated swagger here. This is a swagger file. And if you want, you can change here. And the changes are reflected back in the design view or the source view. So this is my base path employee. And I have a, this is the get all. So I will just add dummy path to my get all. And you can see it is added. And if I go to the design view and go to the get all annotations, you can see that here. But if you go to the code, the get all has only the slash. So we have, you can change the contract here and there. It has like very deep relationship with the ballerina service, swagger, and the source view, right? So the next feature that we can demonstrate in the composer is the debugging capability. So for example, think of how you can debug a sequence diagram. We'll show you like in a few minutes. So I'm going to open another sample. I'm going to not save it. Go here.
So we're running a little bit behind. We'll try to show a couple more things, and then there'll be a place where you guys can get more help.
Yeah. So quickly go to this insert employee, which has some bunch of statements. I'll put a breakpoint here. Right. So let me check whether I have any other services started. So I'll stop it. Any more services? Only the composer. Yeah, all good. And so what I can do is I can basically go to the debugger and start, this is service, start the service with the debugger. Right, so it started. So I can hit a request. I can do a post because this is an insert and see the behavior. So let me go to the correct debugger sample. Right? And basically have a ready-made command so that I'm going to change the ID. I'm adding an employee here. all right? Yeah, so I'm not getting any response because it's probably stuck here in the editor. So you get a debug point, and you can see your variables here. So the JSON, this message is complex value, so you really can't see what's inside. But if you step over, now you can see your request payload. Quickly, yeah, this is the response I sent, request I sent. And then you go, and it will basically extract values from the JSON request, and you can see the values, the employee ID, birth date, going one by one, first name, last name. So apparently, there's a bug. Both names are same. So maybe we can fix it here, and then continue debugging. So if you can see, you don't get any response until you basically complete. This is usual debugging stuff. And then you come to the last status. Until you reply, you're not going to get anything. When you reply, you get the output. So this demonstrates the debugging capability of Composer.
OK, we have a bunch more demos planned, but we're clearly running behind a little bit, so we'll cut over. And there's a booth at the back. You are more than welcome to go by. And all this code is there as well. So OK, thank you, Samir. OK, that was my fault, not his fault, because I think I clearly spoke for too long. OK, let me briefly talk about Ballerina future, and then we'll be done, and we'll go for lunch. So when is this thing useful? It's really a simple 80-20 rule. If the 80% of the work that you're doing in your program is related to talking to other stuff, then Ballerina is perfect. Right? It's a hell of a lot easier to write a program in Ballerina to do that than in Java or any other language. Absolutely hands down, and there's a lot of stuff that just makes it so much easier. If it's the other way around, it's completely useless. If it's 20-80 the other way around, it's not the right answer. And everything in between is subjective. Right? So there are lots of scenarios where it makes a lot of sense. There are lots of scenarios where it doesn't make sense. And there's a bunch of scenarios where, you know, it depends on the environment and context and so forth. It's also a really great way to, so we kind of use this term micro-integration services. So it's microservices in the sense that they're tiny. They're very fast. You notice how fast it booted up, right? And this is still without much optimization with BM. Literally been working on this intensely for the last several months. So this is not a production release at all. It's still a 0.8 release and so forth. So it boots up extremely fast. It's designed to come up in very low memory footprint, very fast response, and so on. So it's really good for this kind of scenarios where you had to write a micro integration service and deploy it in lots of places or on a small machine to whatever environment. It's also great when you want to recompose existing stuff. So if you've done, if your business is organized into a bunch of services and you create new capabilities, right? Which is that 30,000 developer scenario that I told you about earlier. What they want to do is they've written a bunch of services already. They have run an SOA program, they have a bunch of services. They need to be able to innovate rapidly and do it at scale. This kind of programming language can actually let you do that quite well, because it's a lot better than the configuration style model that was there. Because it has a main, it's also an awesome way to actually run command line programs. Now, he was using curl, but those curl commands could have been written in one line of Ballerina as well. Right? It's actually about three lines. You import, create the HTTP connector, and say post. Other than that, it's the same thing. So many system administration tasks now involve touching the network. There was a time when system administration meant editing files and use sed and vi and all kinds of stuff, shell scripts to do things. But today, system administration involves interacting with the different systems and using curl and web forms and so forth. This thing is very good at that kind of stuff. So it's like a shell script language as well. Now the other obvious question. How does this affect the WSO2 products? Like, what's the implication for this for the products? So first thing is, Ballerina is not a product. It's a technology. It is something we are, it's open source. It's completely open. We expect, we hope anybody can use it. We don't, you know, we have no issue with competitors using it. Anybody can use it. It's a programming language. Of course, we will use the product, right? I mean, use the technology rather. That's why we created it, because we want to use it. So the future versions of API Manager, Enterprise Integration, Identity Server will actually use Ballerina as its core engine. So in the API Manager case, the API Gateway will be running on top of Ballerina. In the case of the Enterprise Integrator, that's the one that's going to be significantly affected. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. The next major version of Enterprise Integrator will be based on Ballerina. And that will effectively be a replacement for the ESP data services and rules and all the sort of the short running execution engines. The identity server has an interesting concept called identity bus that Prabhat Srivadana, who's the head of our security architecture team, he has a bunch of talks I think you should go and attend if you can, has come up with, which we plan to implement using Ballerina as well. Where to bring identity as a first class data type into the language is something we are considering too. So the one that gets affected mostly is version 7. OK, so what does that mean? Because we have a lot of people using the ESP and products and so on. So we are obviously not going to dump the other one and run by any means. So both versions will run in parallel for quite a while. This is a common model. So Tomcat does this all the time. Tomcat usually runs 3 major releases in parallel. So here we're going to be running 2 releases in parallel, integrated version 6. Family will keep going, as well as version 7 when it gets ready and going. When is it going to be ready? We don't have a particular timeline right now because there's more work that we need to do to make Ballerina solid enough to say it's in a product that we can ship. Ballerina is usable. It's not like, you know, it works, and we put a lot of effort to making it into a very stable runtime. Enterprise Integrated Version 6 will absolutely continue to be supported. We have no end-of-life plan or anything like that. We plan to continue it open-ended and so forth. We will be working on a migration tool that will take ESB and data service configuration and generate Ballerina out of it. We think we can do about 80% of configurations can be brought over without any effort. But there will be stuff that, especially if you've written, in the case of ESB, any kind of Java-based mediators, we can't migrate those over, obviously. And so forth. But there are things that we can handle quite a bit. So this is not, you know, if you are an ESP user, obviously this is not a lovely thing for you to hear. At the same time, we have to keep moving, and I think if we don't keep moving forward, we are doing you guys a disservice. So as a result, we are very focused on saying we are not going to stop support or make it difficult for people to use the products as they stand right now. Same time, we're not going to stop innovating and trying to create different ways in which hitting and solving these kind of problems. All right, so we're done finally. So this is available right now. So what's available right now is it's what we are calling a technology preview. It's 0.8 technology preview. All this stuff is available. There's a language runtime. You can run it once, run it as a service, run like a bus-like model where you deploy a bunch of services and you give a directory and say run everything. The developer tools are available, the composer, the IDEA plugins, TestArena, Dockerina, and a whole bunch of sample connectors. The connectors are still packaged into the runtime distribution. We are keeping the connectors not in ballerina.something packages because that's kind of wrong right now. So those are in org WSO2 packages, temporarily packaged into the Ballerina distribution. We'll be separating those out and making them third-party connectors that you can still download and use. Right? Because otherwise, it's kind of... you don't want, for example, Ballerina to know how to talk to Twitter. That doesn't make sense. That's just another API. I didn't mention there's also a tool that can take a Swagger and generate a Ballerina connector. So if you have a Swagger file for a service, you can run Swagger to Bell, and it'll just generate your connector and just import it and use it. So you don't have to write any code to use an existing thing and integrate it very easily. That's our website, ballerinalang.org. You can go there right now. It should be live. And you can download and play with it and do whatever you want. Next steps, download, go have some dancing with it. I had a different word there, I was asked to change it. And give us feedback. This is truly an open source project. The spec, everything is open. We had an internal dev list while we were working on it. That list was shut down at 9 a.m. this morning. We have now created a Google group. We all migrated into that group. So you will see all our internal, you know, there's no internal anymore. It's basically completely external. All the conversations will be there. There's a lot more work to be done. We'd love to get you know, more in-depth feedback, any challenges, any pain you have while trying it out. We'd love to hear that. Yeah, we want this to be, you know, this is a language that's designed with all the modern programming language concepts taken into account, we hope. And I'm sure we didn't get it all right. So we'd love to get your feedback and challenge us as well, and look forward to working with you guys.